end of verse 12. I want to talk about, last class we talked about the inward parts. This class we want to talk about the head. And Jesus, we know Jesus is the head of the church, right? He's also the head of the body. All right, Leviticus 1, verse 8. And the priest, Aaron's son, shall lay the parts, the head and the fat, in order upon the wood that is on the fire, which is upon the altar. And then also verse 12. He shall cut it into pieces with its head and its fat, and the priest shall lay them in order on the wood that is on the fire, which is upon the altar. So again, I'm going to go back to reading so that I can make some progress, and I felt pretty good about last class, actually. The burnt offering's head was cut off. The head of the burnt offering represents examining Jesus's view and way of thinking. Since the head was cut off, it is a representation of cross wisdom. It is wisdom that has gone through or undergone death. If we join with Jesus as the burnt offering, we will experience certain things. In a very practical way, Paul's head was eventually cut off. In a spiritual way, Paul left his own view of things, for Christ was his life. The offerer's sacrifice was a demonstration of what concerning the death of Christ that he understood and entered into. And this is again another reference back to the whole point of the sweet savor offerings was not judgment over sin. It was, and there were different offerings, and we'll get into that later, but there were different offerings based on the different levels of where people were at with the Lord. Not the fullness of Christ, their personal experience of Christ, where they offered Christ to the degree that they understood him. So, in a very practical, the offer's sacrifice was a demonstration of what concerning the death of Christ that he understood and had entered into. But let us be clear about something. Christ is not just our wisdom. He is first our head. And with that comes the mind of Christ. And with that comes the wisdom of God in a mystery. I'm not going to take the time to explain the wisdom of God in a mystery, folks, but it's not just like deep teaching we're talking about. The wisdom of God in a mystery, as described in the Bible, is, shall I say, cross wisdom. It is, where do we get this from? 1 Corinthians chapter 1, primarily 1 Corinthians chapter 2, where it said, had the princes of this world known and understood the cross, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But they don't understand the cross. See, they only understand the way that you win, is that you defeat and run over the top of the person that you consider your enemy. Jesus says, love your enemies. Do good to your enemies. Bless those. See, that's cross wisdom. And people of the world, that's why I said, the prince of this world, had they understood? But they don't understand. And I'll just be honest with you, most Christians do not understand this wisdom because they've started with their own head instead of him being the head. This wisdom does not come into your head. This wisdom comes by him being your head. And that's where the big failure has come, is that we've tried to gain knowledge without changing heads. Jesus is the head. Jesus is the head of the body. And see, we need to quit acting like Christians alone or independent agents and realize that we are joined and one with him and just a member through which Christ expresses his mind, through which Christ expresses his nature, through which Christ expresses himself, his character. All right, so But let's see. He is first our head, and with that comes the mind of Christ, and with that comes the wisdom of God in a mystery. In the case of the burnt offering, the head was something offered to God. In other words, it is something he wants from us. I mean, isn't that interesting? I mean, anybody ever read this stuff and notice that they opened up the sacrifice and they pulled the guts out and examined it, you know, and then they cut the head off and then they offer it to God and they, you know. I mean, if you were actually doing that, you know, you'd go, yuck, you know. I mean, this is, you know. And you're going, why are we cutting the head off and then, you know, lifting it to God? And I don't know that I get into that in all of this. I'm not sure. But for sure, one part that I didn't get the chance to get into when I was talking about what does it mean to be a New Testament priest was the consecration of the priest. And one of the things that the priest to be consecrated do is a very similar thing as the burnt offering. They have to open up the parts and they have to get into it and they have to pull it out and they have to wave it before the Lord and say, look, I'm getting this. This is, you know, there's a whole thing. It's very big that will consecrate you as a priest, because if you don't do that, you're just a dude saying you're a priest or dudette, you know, as the case may be. So the head was something offered to God. In other words, it's something that he wants from us. He wants the mind of Christ, but he's not going to get the mind of Christ unless Christ is our head. And we offer him Christ. We offer his mind through us to the Father. 1 Corinthians 2:16 declares we have the mind of Christ, but only when we act as his body, because he's not the head of Christians. Nowhere is that phrase used. Jesus is the head of Christians. He's the head of the body, you know. So we have to act, and the difference being, you know, I make that distinction a lot. Maybe you've never really comprehended my point, but the point is, the distinction being that a Christian is an independent person living his own life, and all he's done basically is change belief systems. He has a belief system. Christ as your head and you as his body means there is a union. You are not yourself anymore. You are joined to Christ and all his resources are available to you. Whatever you can't do, and I don't mean, you know, drive a bus or something like that. I mean, whatever you can't do anybody ever got real angry and you couldn't control your anger? Well, Christ is supposed to be able to come through us as his body. You know, I don't know where anger resides in the body, but I never feel it in my hand. It might want to come through my hand to him, but I never, you know, in other words, if I am just a member of his body, then what is in his head and what is in his heart we're giving you the potential, can come through you. Now, we're talking about anger, but, you know, jealousy or strife or criticism or anything else, anything that's not Christ, you know, you can rush to a book that you read that really said it perfectly and try to get the mind of Christ by reading that book. But one thing that will work way better is a faith acknowledgement that you are joined to Christ as his body and that your hope and your desire and your faith is that what is in him will flow into you. And victory will come. And then read your book. You know. Then read the book, and you're operating on a different basis. The basis isn't the basis of reading a book. And for sure, the basis isn't trying to get the wisdom of God in a mystery to work in your mind. Good luck with that one. You see what I mean? I mean, that's tough stuff, man. And then you get frustrated and you go, why can't I get this? Anybody ever, you know, slapped yourself or whatever? Why don't I get this? What is wrong with you? You know, looking in the mirror, you stupid. You know better. Well, yeah, except for it's your mind working in you and you're trying to put his thoughts. The Bible doesn't say, you know, have the thoughts of Christ. It says have the mind of Christ. But you're trying to put his thoughts in your mind. See, and your mind will take it for a little while and then it'll jumble it all up, and before too long when your mind spits it back out, it's ugly again. You know, I mean, it is. And that's yours, that's mine, that's us. That's us apart from Christ. Why do you think you came to Jesus? Anybody know why you came to Jesus? Because I didn't want to go to hell. No. Okay, well. I would hope there's more to it than, you know, not going to hell and Cadillacs. Or whatever, I don't know. All right. All right, let's, still in Leviticus 1, let's read verse 6 again. And he shall flay the burnt offering and cut it into its pieces. One of the things that the burnt offering does is it is cut up. It is cut into pieces. All right. Before the sacrifice can be examined properly, before it can be examined properly, something important must happen. It must be cut into pieces. Only in this way can it be divided out and examined properly. The offerer who does this more carefully, the offerer who does this moves carefully forward as he's dividing and cutting it up, line upon line, taking note of each part. They are not going to the Bible as a tourist, but they are searching for the inward heart of Jesus, making sure that nothing is missed. It is only by the death of Jesus he was able to truly exhibit the fullness of his lamb nature. And I remember when I saw that when I was in Bible school, I saw that he was the Lamb of God. It wasn't something he did. It wasn't an act. In other words, Jesus didn't just go to the cross at one time event and satisfy the whole world because of the big thing he did. Jesus did not fully manifest who he was until the cross. That the healings didn't fully manifest, because he's the Lamb of God before the foundation of the world. At the end of the book of Revelation, he's the Lamb of God. Healing people didn't show that. Blessing people didn't show that. Feeding people didn't fully show that. But when he was on that cross, forgiving the very people that were doing that stuff to him, he showed his true being and nature. It took the cross to even come close to start knowing who Jesus is. I mean, knowing him. Everybody knows what he did. Oh, he died for me, so I won't have to go to hell, and I thank God for that, you know. I'm gonna go to heaven, and I can't wait to swim in the river of life and try to drown myself. Because there's no more death, so I'm gonna have fun just trying to drown myself. What? Well, if you wonder where weird thoughts like that come from, it was my thought. When I became a Jesus freak. Look there, there's a river. And it's a river of life. So I'm going to try to drown myself. I know. That's why I needed the mind of Christ. All right. In cutting the sacrifice to pieces, we're able to see the devastation Jesus was put through at the cross. In other words, we don't see this. We just see him die up there, but folks, he was cut to pieces. When brought before his accusers, they cut Jesus from so many angles that his true form was marred, and no one could perceive him as whole. As whole. Now that's incredibly important because most of your pride relates to you appearing whole to people. This is part of what cutting and dividing does. It obscures the people's eyes from seeing Jesus in wholeness. Or if you're included in this, if you're a fellowship in his sufferings, you will be cut up so bad, cut down so bad, put down in such a way that people will not be able to ever perceive you as whole again. There will always be some stigma, some this, some that, that mars your true being. And I'll just read it. But when Jesus went through the trial and when he went through all of that, he was already marred. He was already being beaten. He was already being, you know. The only way they would know who he really was is that if he made some demonstration aside from the marred exterior reputation and appearance that he had. And he wouldn't do it. He didn't do it. He stood there like a sheep and held his mouth and didn't justify himself and just flat died. Just flat died because he's the Lamb of God. And that's the biggest manifestation of God you could have seen, but they couldn't see that. They looked at that as it's proof that he's guilty. He's not saying anything. He's not justifying himself. Everybody justifies himself. It's the way of human nature. We all justify himself and he's not doing it. Anybody see what I'm saying? I mean, we all justify ourselves, which is very, very wrong, but we do it. So it obscures the people's eyes from Jesus, seeing Jesus in wholeness. The true form of the sacrifice is lost amidst the blood, guts, and negative reaction towards such a slaughtered appearance. You remember in Isaiah 53, it says that he was so marred that, you know, this aspect is added in as part of the death of the cross. Not just physically dying, but literally losing your wholeness in the eyes of others so that it can never be pieced together again except by people who can see by the Spirit. And how many do we really have of that? When we talk about seeing by the Spirit, Our first thought is, you know, well, that means somebody that can have discerning of spirits or somebody that can get a word of knowledge or whatever. Folks, there are people who can function in the gifts of the Spirit so incredibly powerful who wouldn't recognize Jesus if they walked by the barn and looked at the manger and saw him laying there. Their mind is so filled with another picture of Jesus, they wouldn't recognize. They'd walk right on past there looking for the place they think he's at. That would be an abomination. That would be a rejection. No, I'm not going to identify with that Jesus. You know, they'd walk right by the cross and they'd see criminal, criminal, and they'd point to the middle guy and say, criminal. Am I right or wrong? They would. It's just, it's not discerning of spirits we're talking about here. Do you have cross wisdom enough to recognize the Son of God when he comes? Israel didn't. I'm telling you. And folks, that didn't just end then with the Jews or the Pharisees or the Romans not recognizing Jesus. It continues on to this day that people cannot see past certain things and they cannot discern Jesus. But I'm going to tell you that it's possible to look at this burnt sacrifice and go, this is exactly what satisfies God. This is the Lamb of God. This is the very one that's going to free everybody. It's insane. It's insane. There's only one way. God has to do a work in you by his mind where the eyes of your understanding are enlightened, not just to see great revelations, but you could see Jesus, like, you know, through your walk, years and years and years. There's Jesus when nobody else recognized him. There's Jesus when nobody else recognized him. I'm telling you that this is real stuff. Now, only the Holy Spirit can work it in you or even show you what I'm talking about. But I'm telling you that there is, that people miss the Son of God. They miss the Lamb of God all the time because they're looking for the resurrected King. You're only going to see him raised up and made sit together in heavenly places. You're only going to see him in heavenly places. Let me tell you, Jesus is the Lamb of God. Can I get amen? Jesus is the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God in heaven is the most glorified thing there is. Can I get amen on that one? He is, but the Lamb of God in the earth is rejected. If you put that lamb in the earth, he's going to be rejected. But you put him in the heavens, everybody's going to glorify. So if Jesus shows up as lamb in you, guess what? Everybody isn't going to come running to you and go, my God, I see Jesus. They're not. A lot of people are going to see a criminal. They're going to see somebody that's hung out, cut up, and they won't see your wholeness. But you see, you're not supposed to go by the outward appearance. Am I right or wrong? The Bible says we shouldn't walk by sight. The Bible says man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. But we're always looking at stuff, and we'll be tripped up. We might luck out this time and that, but we're going to be tripped up until this cross wisdom is worked into us. And then you're not so quick to judge things. I'm telling you the truth. You're not so quick to judge. It's almost like every time they haul out a criminal, you kind of, a little flag goes up, and you go, let's not judge this so quickly. Do you understand what I'm trying to say here? You're going, this could be Jesus. This could be Christ in somebody. This could be not everything everybody says that it is. This could be the Lord. Okay? And if you just build a relationship with God and just ask him, Lord, help, don't be so quick to judge things. Just ask him, Lord, Father, I don't want to miss your son. All right, let's read on here. It is for this reason that many Christians would never want to be involved with identification with Jesus in this offering. Much of Christianity is seeking wholeness. Now, am I right or wrong? Right there. That is a true statement. Much of Christianity is seeking wholeness and would reject fellowshipping in these kinds of sufferings that would cause you to be to at least appear less than whole. They seek God to gather up the fragments of their lives. Since we have not entered into oneness in Christ's death in practical ways, when cut up by others, we usually retaliate or justify ourselves. And this is a proof whether when the people come to cut you up, when they start cutting you up, and they start cutting you down, that's when you find out if it's the burnt offering or you. Because once you start cutting things up and you start getting on the inside, then you start seeing motivations you may never knew you had. I'm telling you, things you never knew you had in you. I know what I'm talking about. Pride that you really thought was not an issue in you. And you go, oh my God, I'm reacting in ways that, And because there is this constant self-focus when it's not the true burnt offering. But when it's the true burnt offering, it's a whole different thing. It's a whole different ballgame. A whole different spirit. I won't get into some of the things that I shared in Holland, but the Lord's been dealing with me on this for some time, and it's a personal issue where I want Christ formed in me so that I never have to care or worry about what man thinks, not because I'm prideful or hard, but because I trust my Father where he is leading me, and I trust that everything he does is to bring forth Christ, whether it be in me or someone else around me or someone 100 years after I'm gone, that these circumstances are not just the devil and they're not just crazy people. It is my Father. And that I can react in the right spirit towards them and toward the situation and not go into a bunch of, you know, inward turmoil and implosion. You know? Well, that's where I'm at. And I'm serious about it. I am serious about it. Let's see. When cut up by others, we usually retaliate or justify ourselves. We do so for one purpose, to remain whole in the eyes of others. Right? I mean, if somebody, you know, we work real hard to present this image. We all do, to get a certain one. And then somebody starts cutting you down, it's like, you know, you're tearing up, you know, we're supposed to be in the image of Christ. Can I get an amen? But we've worked on an image apart from Christ. It's us. It's very, don't touch that. And they start cutting you down. They're destroying the full picture of wholeness about you. And so we start, you know, reacting over that. We do so for one purpose, to remain whole in the eyes of others. We do not like to appear publicly as incomplete and disjointed. I mean, if we'd all be honest, isn't it true that we might be able to say, I'm a jerk, I'm an idiot. Anybody ever walk around and in your head rehearse stuff like that? Other than me, am I the only one? I mean, I do. I mean, my most common thing when I got up in the morning and looked in the mirror was, you're an idiot. No, I'm serious, you know. But I tell you what. That's my business if I look in the mirror and call me an idiot, but don't you call me an idiot. That's what I thought, you know, and I thought I was sort of humble in a certain way by saying stuff like that. You know what I mean? I mean, I was, you know, well, I found out there's no humility behind that at all, because when somebody else called me an idiot, pride just, what are you saying? I'm not whole? Well, you said it. Yeah, but don't you say it. God's going to allow you to be cut up so you can find out what's on the inside. Let's hope it's Jesus, amen? And if it's, you know what, if it's not Jesus, that's okay too, because now we know we need to seek Jesus more to be formed in us. I mean, am I right or wrong? That really is the deal. You know, you can sit there and whine and say, it's not Jesus, it wasn't Jesus, all my actions weren't Jesus, my whole life hasn't been Jesus, I'm a failure, my God, kill me, I'm a loser, you know? Why don't you kill me? Or you can say, I'm a loser, I'm a failure, I need to die and everything, but you know what? God, from this point on, why don't you begin to form Christ in me? Instead of whining over how bad I am, and trust me, you're as bad as me. You may not know it yet, but you are. And here's the scary part, I'm as bad as you. But it's true. That is who we are until Christ is formed. So let's get on with the Christ being formed part instead of the putting down of what's not Christ. You know? Let's get on to the positive side of going after Jesus instead of beating up on, you know, Adam. You know, the Bible doesn't say, if Adam be put down, I'll draw all men to me. He said, if I be lifted up. You know? All right, let's see. It hurts our pride to appear less than complete. We protect ourselves and resist every attempt on the part of others to cut us down. However, Paul experienced such things as mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. He described himself as, and this is the Apostle Paul, defamed, the off-scouring. The scum of the earth, basically. That's the way he described himself as seen by other people. We always say, oh, the great Apostle Paul. Everybody loved him and respected him and had high esteem for him. You know, I was when I was in Holland, I got a little spare time in the middle of the night when I couldn't sleep. Oh, man, I didn't sleep hardly at all. Anyway, so I'm laying there, and I break out the Word of God. And, you know, you're just watching Paul and Barnabas and the group that's going with them. And they go into this one place, and they go into the synagogue, and, you know, they're all excited, and they want to share Jesus, and they start sharing Jesus. And the heathen people that are in there, because there were people that weren't pure Jews, they started getting into the message, and the Jews didn't like it, and they started putting them down and started attacking them and started doing all this stuff and finally ran them out of their city, so they went to the next city, and you'd think everything would be okay. These people packed up and followed them to the next city and started attacking them there and then kept doing it, I mean, and doing all this stuff, man. And spreading it all around. These guys are, I'm telling you, don't listen to them. Can you imagine? Well, I can do more than imagine, but anyway. Can you imagine Paul knowing that this is the truth that not only will save your soul, but that will free you right now by the life of Christ? And people are stirred up, calling him, what do we say, defaming him, making him the off-scouring. And all he's trying to do is share Jesus. I mean, he's really not trying, you know, there's nothing else at work there. I mean, think about it. There's nothing else really at work there. He's just trying to share Jesus. And they're hunting him from town to town. Burnt offering. You gotta find out the true thing going on. Here is one who is daily offering the burnt offering, talking about Paul. If we are caught up in gaining reputation in this earth, we might find ourselves rejecting to identify with Jesus in the burnt offering. The burnt offering does not gain honor and respect in the earth, but only in the nostrils of God. God's going, you know, I mean, look at that. I mean, they're chasing him. They're beating him. They're throwing him in prison. They're doing all this stuff. Paul's going, this is hard, man. This is not easy. This is hard. And he's probably thinking, I wish that these people would get off my back. Do you think? Well, probably not, because he's more spiritual than me. But the Father's sitting there going, I'm getting my son, and that's what I'm after first, is not your happy ministry, but my son and the essence, not your bodily ministry, body form, bullock, sheep, lamb, you know, turtle dove ministry. But Paul said, what was gained to me, I count loss for Christ. You know, that the Father may gain his Son in these ways. The burnt offering, let's see. Jesus said that if they have done those things to him, they will do them to you. Jesus was cut up by the tongue of others. Jesus was slaughtered. He was stripped. And he was cut to pieces. It is hard to comprehend that this was the will of God for one who did not deserve this. Anybody ever feel under attack because you didn't deserve it? Folks, it doesn't matter whether you deserve it or not. That's not it. Whether you deserve it is not the issue. Whether you've been good or done it right, whether I've done everything is not the issue. The issue is, do I want to give the Father his Son? Do I? That's the question, isn't it? It's not the issue, it's the question. It becomes the issue when we answer the question in a positive way. Do I want to give the Father his Son? And if I do, then there is no place for attacking those who would attack you. There is no place for being angry against God wanting you to join in fellowship with his Son. You're free. You're free to love. You're free to give. You're free, but only by Christ and only by his life. We might feel the same way when we come to this, but Jesus did not show God's power and his virtue by praying his way out of it. He showed God's mastery over himself by going through it in a right spirit. For example, when I was reading in Holland at night, I was deeply touched by something that I saw Jesus. He was in the Garden of Gethsemane, and Peter, James, and John were there, and Jesus said, you know, pray and that you don't fall into temptation. And Jesus went to pray, and the Bible says, being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. And it says that the pressure was so great that he was sweating great drops of blood. And he got up, because he's going through it. Let this cup pass from me, but nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. He is so going through it. And he gets up and he finds the disciples asleep. And here's what he says. Watch and pray. And if that had been me, if I had been going through agony, folks, I promise you, I would have walked over to those disciples and said, pray for me. Jesus never said, pray for me. I don't know if you can see it, but it broke my heart about me. That I know that everything comes back here. Everything, you know. Jesus didn't refocus everything back on himself. I'm going through a hard time. Can't you guys just pray for me? He just said, watch and pray. And I flashed through much of my life, and you know, that if you're weak and if you're down and out, you want help, but that can be your soul. If you're weak and down and out, you want compassion. That's probably your flesh. I'm not saying you can't get compassion. I'm just saying, what is your true heart and motivation behind that? Anyway, these are the things the Lord's been sharing with me. I don't want to get off in that too much, but just the fact that he showed God, he could have called 10,000 angels, but he didn't show God's power over the bad guys. He showed God's mastery over himself by going through it in a right spirit. Not just going through it, but going through it in a right spirit. You know? Hallelujah. How much time we got? We don't. Okay. Well, this next one may be a... Yeah, we'll see how we do. This one is Leviticus 1, 6 and 12. And it's the word used in verse 6 is flay, but it means to skin it. And he shall flay the burnt offering and cut it into pieces. And then also verse 12, and he shall cut it into pieces with its head and its fat, and the priest shall lay it in order on the wood. I guess that one didn't really say it. But just the fact that it is skin. Of course, being slain and cut up is only the beginning of conforming to his death. It also includes skinning. To skin is to make naked. To make naked, to be made raw and exposed. The reputation that others have seen us in is removed from sight, meaning the outward thing that has appealed is skinned off of you, and you're just a raw, exposed thing. And if they don't know the Lord, and if they can't get in touch with the spirit of the thing, then they're just going to be fooled by the outward circumstances. That's all there is to it. That's all there is to it. Because your reputation, your presentation has been cut away in that sense. All that was of good man and healer and prophet are taken away, and now you're seen as a criminal. Skinning is the willing allowance of the removal of the outward protection. Now that's important, because the things that you've had up to protect you, and your skin is your greatest protector just about. It protects you from all sorts of disease and everything else. Skinning is the willing allowance of the removal of outward protection. Man, you talk about hard. Or you're not going to rely on the things you did before. You know, some people know how to manipulate people to protect themselves. Some people know how to use power. Some people know how to use intimidation. And when you drop all that, you're just truly, it's like Jesus, in one sense, you could say Jesus said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And of course, you know that people slapped him and did all that kind of stuff. So it doesn't mean you'll be totally protected. It means that you will be one with him in the sacrifice. If someone sees things of value in a person, he will be less harsh. Am I right? If somebody sees something of value in somebody, they won't be so harsh. Well, you're a good person, or you've got a nice personality, or you're humble, or something like that. If someone sees things of value in a person, they're going to be less harsh to them. But at his trial, Jesus did not present a godly exterior, but let the accusers take it all away. Jesus was stripped of showing in outward form the expression of his inward being. He was stripped of his outward form. Of showing in outward form the expression of his inward being. He spoke a few words, but only a few. He gave no outward sign that he was God's son. As offering, he gave himself. The burnt offering not only gave its life, but was willing to give its skin. I don't know if you get that or not, but that's bigger. That's almost bigger than giving your life. It's like somebody pulls a gun, you say, just shoot me. But just shoot me for the glory of God is one thing. But having your skin removed and all outward protection and all wholeness and all done like that, I think I'd rather somebody just shoot me and me die a glorious death for Jesus than be ripped apart and be exposed in front of everybody and have no recourse. You understand what I'm saying? The burnt offering not only gave its life, but was willing to give its skin. What protected it from germs, invasion, and make it not appear as uncovered was removed and stripped. This action exposed him to the harmful influences of the world. Though God, people openly accused him without fear of retribution. I mean, can you imagine if God appeared here and then we just started accusing him? You'd go, don't do that, man, that's God. But Jesus became like a stripped animal. And they said, well, there's nothing to fear here. If God was with him, he'd protect him, right? And so they just hurled their accusations freely. They spread rumors that he was demon-possessed or mentally unstable, John 8:48 and John 10:20. There's a scripture in Leviticus 7, verse 8. Let me just read this, but here is a different part of the burnt offering. In Leviticus 7:8, we discovered that the skin that was stripped from the offering actually becomes a covering for the priest. Okay, now this is going to be a little different part of this burnt offering. Let me finish reading this. When the burnt offering was done by an individual, not the continual burnt offering that was done at the temple for the congregation, which was a continual burnt offering, right? Morning and night, the priest did that. But an individual could offer a burnt offering. In that case, when they stripped off the covering and the ability to outwardly express who you were, that was given to the priest. It wasn't burned up. It's the only part that wasn't burned up. But only in case of the individual, not for the congregation. Isn't that an interesting thought? That under one condition, if an individual is giving their burnt offering, when they flayed that thing and stripped off its skin and everything, they didn't burn it. They put it over on the priest. When the burnt offering was done by an individual, the offering priest got to keep the skin. During his crucifixion, what Christ could not openly show, we can. What he was restricted from showing, we can put on. When we offer a lamb, for example, because you can offer a lamb for a burnt offering, when we offer a lamb, we take on the covering and outward look of that offering. Isn't that cool? You offer it up and then you put him on. We are changed into that same image. We are clothed upon with Christ. This verse is not just some random thought, but is in line with the fulfilling of the Old Testament. Meaning, when it says we're clothed upon with Christ, folks, how is that done? I'm telling you that it's done by the fulfillment of the Old Testament, the Old Testament sacrifices, not just put on Christ. Oh, you know, I mean, I knew somebody said, I put on Christ every day. Well, I said, well, how do you do that? And they said, I get up in the morning and I put my arms and I put him on. I went, well, if somebody walked up and slapped you while you were doing that, what would you do? Well, I'd probably slap them back. Well, then you didn't put on Christ, you see. But this is talking about the priest put on Christ. And that outward glory that Jesus didn't show in his death, he gives to us to wear and to be able to manifest Christ to other people. We put ye on the one who gave up his life. We put on the one who gave up his life. In Genesis 3:21, we note that Adam and Eve also got to keep the skin of the burnt offering. Did you know that, Adam and Eve? God offered an offering. It was a burnt offering. And then he clothed them. They were meant to walk, not in their own righteousness, but clothed in Christ. Remember that the burnt offering is given not because of sin, but because of its self-giving nature. What ministers to God is Christ in this spirit. So when Paul says he was a minister in 2 Corinthians 6, 3 through 13, and he does say he was a minister, one of the proofs was that it was through both being honored and dishonored and through evil report and good report. This skinning was proof that he was a true burnt offering, which is an offering acceptable to God. Most ministers think that being skinned by the public dishonors God. Now, let me say that. We think if you get your reputation and you get your honor and you get everything stripped away, that this dishonors God. While it may bring dishonor to our outward reputation, yet to God it is a sweet savor when done by Christ's life. That doesn't mean as much to you right now. Wait till you've been stripped of your honor and reputation and everything's taken away. And see if you don't say, this dishonors God. Me having a bad name, this is not good. This is dishonoring God. Because we think that if I have honor, then I use that to honor God. And if I get more honor, God gets more honor. Not if God gets more honor, I get more. We think if I get more honor, then God gets more honor. And the more honor I get, so Lord, give me more honor and give me more reputation, because that's going to make you look better. You know, I remember when I was a Jesus freak, barely born again, and I thought, I told our little group, the bunch of Jesus freak, long-haired, hippie, Jesus-loving people, let's pray right now, and let's pray till the day we die that Mick Jagger gets saved. And I remember saying, because what a testimony that would be to God. How great that would be. You know, God is great without Mick Jagger getting saved. But I mean, Rolling Stones. Yeah, no, that's it. We think that that's, you know, if we've got all this honor, then God's getting more honor. But the truth is, the burnt sacrifice was dishonored in being flayed and ripped to pieces and everything else, and God was getting a sweet savor. The honor was the spirit in which it was being given, not that it didn't go through anything bad. All right, let me try this last paragraph. How much time we got? Nine? But who but Christ would undergo total defamation publicly with no fear concerning earthly reputation? Well, it's going to take Christ in us. After all, to be skinned is to have our beauty taken from us. It is that part of us that we have put forward to the public, our outward show that is removed and taken from us. How can I honor God anymore being flayed? I'll tell you how. By dying in the right spirit. By loving your enemies. By turning the other cheek. By seeing that God didn't decide to make you an offering in this circumstance. And then you rise out of it and you live in resurrection for 3 years until he brings you to another circumstance. No, not in this case. God chose and thought, you know what? You might actually be able to live as a continual burnt offering. You might actually be able to do it on a daily basis, continuously, not a daily death and resurrection, but a continual dying in the earth, with a continual uprising, what ascends up? Christ to the Father. Christ to the Father. Most resist the process or seek to regain what was lost. And that's the thing right there. We end up, God starts honoring his Son as a burnt offering in us, and we start resisting the process because cutting up is happening, because flaying is happening, because all this is going. We resist that because, you know, it's got to be the devil. And then I said, most resist the process or seek to regain what was lost. What was it? Mordecai and Haman. You know, there was a death, but then Mordecai was raised back up into great honor again. We want to seek to regain what was lost, but then I wrote this. Most resist the process or seek to regain what was lost, thinking that a living cow with skin is more valuable to God than a stripped, burned up offering. Let's think of that. The stripped, burned up offering is Christ. The other is just a cow. I mean, it's a cow. God's going, oh, man, let's not let anything happen to a cow. Now, I know in India they do that because their gods are cows. they worship cows. But our God is not a cow, nor does he worship a cow. And he doesn't go, he looks at that cow or that bull or that lamb, and he says, you're a living cow, all right. You know? And I own the cattle on 1,000 hills. Right? That's a scripture too. So you're just one of a bunch on a hill on 1,000 hills. But then he looks and sees that one offered. He says, this is my beloved son. You know, can you see the cow walking around in front of the others? He's been working hard on making his fur look good, you know, and, you know, his hide look good. And, you know, I'm a Christian cow. You know, I have kept myself looking good so I can honor God. And God's looking at that and kind of going, you're a cow for God's sake. You know? But one of them says, let's enter into the fellowship of his sufferings. Let's be made conformable to his death. Oh, I don't want to do that. I've worked hard to get myself where I am. I've spent my whole Christian life getting to this place, and to have it all stripped away in one act would be horrible. Yeah, but what if that was Jesus? Well, I'll just honor God with my testimony. I'll honor God with my testimony. How about honoring God with Christ? No. I want to look good. And so the testimony way plays right into my hands. I want to look good. Well, what's funny is, and I'll try to close with this, but what's funny is we usually end up, because of Adam and not Christ, we usually end up doing something stupid anyway and looking bad. I'd rather look bad because it's Christ and it's the burnt offering, you know. Let's see if I can finish the last sentence here. But to be such is more in tune with identifying in his sufferings. His sufferings are as an offering and not just incidents in life. And what I mean by that, and this is my final deal, the sufferings of Christ are what he went through as a sacrifice in fulfillment of the old covenant. It wasn't just Jesus walking around, you know, in life in general, and he walks up and he bangs his knee on the, you know, stump there at the Jordan River when he's going to get baptized. Oh, man, y'all need to enter into my sufferings. I'm hurting. I really banged up my knee. That's not the sufferings of Christ. The sufferings of Christ relate to the sacrifices. The sufferings of Christ mean entering into oneness with him in these things, whereby Christ literally is the offering, and he's the spirit in which it's being offered. He's also the spirit that fills you so that you can be with him in glory instead of freaking out. For example, what does it say? Rejoice when men persecute you and speak evil of you. Rejoice and weep not, for so persecuted they the prophets before you. So we say, okay, amen to that scripture until we start being persecuted. But if we enter into his sufferings, we enter into his spirit. And his spirit rejoices. He can be free to rejoice, to give the Father what he wants, to be separated as a offering and a sweet savor to God, an offering made by fire. It is a fire offering. And we'll get into that later, but only the fire brings out what this savor is really like and what this offering is really about. All right, we'll stop right there. And hopefully we'll make it to the end of this course. Anybody know, any offhand, anybody here know when the end of the semester is? What, where are we at? The middle? So we probably only got 2 more weeks then, right? Which is 4 more classes. Okay, well, then there's a good chance we might make it if I keep reading and don't talk so much. You're dismissed.